seek to be basic. And we do have basic ministries in the building.
Amen.
Thank you, Pastor Moose, as well, for you guys and your congregation coming out to worship with us today. But what you'll have today, it won't be a whole lot of songs, won't be a whole lot of extras, won't be a whole lot of performing. It will be two preachers who will stand up and preach the gospel. In between those two messages, we'll take the Lord's Supper, we'll have communion. We feel that that is the way we respond to the gospel, is by receiving, listen to this, Christ himself. Being reminded that that is our hope, what he has done for us in his life and in his death. And so we're continuing in a series as I open up for our first message this morning. For those of you who have your Bible, if you wouldn't mind grabbing Romans chapter 8. We've been in a series entitled The Whole Scheme of Salvation. The whole scheme of salvation from start to finish. And what we've been saying is that salvation from start to finish is God's work. If somebody is going to be saved, God don't have to do something. If anybody is going to, and I know we talk about heaven often, if anybody is going to heaven, listen to this, it's going to be because God has done something.
All right. Yeah.
We've been talking from this standpoint in our foundational scripture. One of them was Jonah passage, Jonah 2 verse 9. And Jonah says this from the belly of the whale. Salvation is of the Lord.
All right.
Now think about his condition. Jonah was in the belly of the whale and it was his own fault.
Yes.
The Lord told him to do something, and he ran away from the call and the command of God. Listen to this. You and I, in our lives, the Bible says, all of us like sheep have gone astray.
Amen.
All of us have run from the call of God. What is the call of God to all of us? Come to Christ.
Amen.
Bow the knee to Christ. Surrender. Stop working. Start resting in what Christ has done for you. But all of us have run from God's call. I remember my grandmama saying, boy, you need Jesus.
All right.
Amen.
But I kept on running. And listen to this. If God had not have got a hold of me, I would still be right.
Amen.
You too.
Amen.
So today we're in this part of the scheme of salvation where it says God justifies those who he has called. We dealt with this idea of God has foreknown a people. Foreknown means to have known beforehand. And it's not just no information. I know all the people that's going to be born, that'll be alive in the world, and, you know, we'll see what happens. But it talks about foreknown is this intimate level of love God has for his people. The Bible says, I have loved you with an everlasting love.
Yes. Yes.
If you are saved today, God didn't just start loving you when you came down the aisle, you start trying to be good, I'm going to start going to church. No, God loved you before you was ever born.
Yes. Yes. Yes.
And so the result of his work on your behalf is, listen to this, I'm alive in him now.
Yes.
His love has done that on my behalf.
Yes. Yes.
So he says he has foreknown the people, those who he has foreknown. Listen to what he did secondly. He predestined.
Yes. Yes.
He predetermined that those people that he was in love with will be conformed to the image of Christ.
Yes.
Conform to the image of Christ. What does that mean? To be like Jesus was in this world. We're not going to be Jesus, but listen to this. God, if he keep working in us, we're going to have some glimpses where we look like he look.
Yes.
Listen, that's what happened with the disciples. They wasn't even called Christians at first. It was called people of the way.
Yeah.
But they started living after Jesus had rose to glory and they knew about it and they was telling people. People said, hold on a second, they look like he was looking. They doing what he was doing. And it says in Antioch, they was first called Christians because they resembled Christ. Well, what do I mean today by resembling Christ? A people who live down here with their eyes up there. A people who live their lives down here like Jesus was, concerned with God's will in this world.
Amen.
First in their own heart, do something in me, God.
Yes.
Do you got challenges on the inside?
Yeah.
Well, it's going to take God to work his will into us to have us, listen to this, live like Jesus would have us to live. Yes. He predestined, he predetermined that there would be a people that would belong to him. And then the scripture says those that he predetermined or he predestined, he called. He said, you. Stop running. Come here. And that calling was a calling that I could not ignore. I talked last week about the call that, you know, sometimes people call me and I see the number, I see who calling, but I don't pick up. You don't do that either. I see who calling. I don't want to talk right now. Not now is what I'm saying. Later, I'll text you back. I'll do something else. But listen to this. We're talking about the call of God, not where he was calling and we couldn't hear, but the call that produced a response in our souls where I had nothing else to do but to yield everything in my body. I remember when I was playing football, and there was a time when, you know, folks, everybody want to be a kickoff returner. Everybody want to be back there, get the ball and return, and get the ball in your hands. And we were in practice getting ready for the first game of the season. And so he said, all right, kickoff return team back there. Now listen, there's only two returners in the back. About seven of us went back there to get that returning spot. We all think we're going to be the returner. And go. And so coach said, I want him and him. My name wasn't in that list. I remember walking off the field. Listen to this. I know what my body looked like because I was depressed. I was mad. I was sad. Why him? Why not me? And the coach saw the body language, and all I heard was, and he was way up the field. He slammed the clipboard. He said, I will not tolerate it. I heard that down in my soul. I ran off the field. Listen to this. I heard that. And there was a response that happened on the inside. It was a voice of authority.
Yes.
It was a voice of command. It was a voice of, I ain't taking that.
Yeah.
When God called me, he was saying, enough is enough. No further will you go in that direction. And listen to this, repentance was his gift. See, the call stopped me in my tracks, and I had to pay attention to who was calling.
Right. Yeah.
And then it says, now today we're dealing with this idea of those who he has foreknown, loved beforehand, those who he has predestined, predetermined that you're going to be mine, those he said, come, stop running from me. He says, those people that he calls to himself, he justifies.
Yeah.
He makes them right with himself. He doesn't demand something from us that we could listen. If he needed something from us, we couldn't give it. Because God demands perfection. He's not like, you know, like I'm going to wink at sin, or I saw you did wrong and I'm going to act like I didn't see that. You know, sometimes I will do it. I'm going to act like I didn't see it. I ain't going to even deal with that. But God says, I saw everything you've done. Matter of fact, listen to this. I saw everything you fought. And the one who we have sinned against, the injured party, has taken great lengths on his own side of the equation to make us acceptable in his sight. So when we're talking about this reality of the whole scheme of salvation, this is for two things. One, it's for the glory of God. That we would be a people who see him as God, you did it all. And secondly, it's for the hope and the happiness of his people. A people who rejoice, because listen to this, one of the great things about him doing it all is, if he did it, listen to this, I can't mess it up. If it was all in his hands, if it's a result of his, listen, he knew me, he determined, he called, he justified, and he did all of that, I can rest in his work. Yeah. Now, if it was on my work, there's no rest I could really have. But I got to always be frantic. Have I done enough? Am I right? It's almost as if I got to get myself right enough to be with God. It's almost like the day I get it right, God, I'm having a good week, a good day. Just kill me so I don't mess this up. Take me out so I don't mess this up. Else I'm on the pins and needles. But because salvation, as Jonah said, is of the Lord, there's hope for his people. And we can serve him with gladness of heart. Rejoicing in his labor on our behalf. And so if you have Romans chapter 8, let's read that, and we're going to look at a couple passages on that. You can keep your Bible in your hand. As we start to begin this work, we want to lay a great foundation for how salvation comes, because we are hoping for salvation in the city of Oakland. We're hoping for folks who don't know about Jesus to know about Jesus in a saving way. And so we want to begin the journey by letting folks know how salvation happens. Romans chapter 8, familiar for us, verse 28 through 30. And it says, and we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. For those who are called according to his purpose, for those whom he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of God. of his son, in order that he might be the firstborn among many brethren. And those whom he predestined, he also called. And those whom he called, he also justified. And those whom he justified, he also glorified. So you see there, that's salvation in its entirety. It starts from eternity past with God foreknown. It ends in eternity future with God glorifying his people, being worshipped for all of eternity. You remember the passage in Revelation, John the writer is saying, he said, I saw a number that no man can count.
Yes.
From every tribe, kindred, tongue, and nation. Listen to this. We already there in God's eye.
Yes.
His people who he's had redeemed from before the world was framed. Listen to this. He has put some people into the Lamb's book of life before the foundation of the world. Your name written. And one of the things that I had to come to understand is that salvation is not like this. Okay, I'm saved, meaning my name is now in the Lamb's book of life. But yesterday I blew it. God erased my name out the book. And now I got to do some stuff to get him to write my name. God would be like, I'm y'all wearing me out with all this getting out, rewriting pieces of paper. No, when God saves, he saves for eternity.
Yes.
All of his works are known from the foundation of the world.
Yes.
So therefore, his people are able to rest in his labors. But I want you to notice something. Justification is this. It is courtroom scene. Justification is legal terminology. It is to declare somebody righteous. To declare, to make a statement about who they are, their standing. And so imagine you go before a judge. Now, how many of y'all been in court before? And had to stand up and say something in court. Listen, I've been in there for parking tickets and small stuff, and I get up to that stand. There's a lot going on the inside. And especially when you got to wait a while, you watch people go before you, and everybody that go up there trying to plead their case, it go bad. The people who just say, yep, I did it, I'm guilty, all of that, then he go right to getting some stuff, and then he start looking. Sometimes they start looking and say, okay, well, I can take that off, and I'll reduce that, and just...
Yeah.
But if you go up there trying to plead your case, and you ain't got a good case, you're in trouble. Well, that's where we are with God. We have no good case to come before him to say anything about our reputation, our character, our standing. We all, as the scripture says in Romans, have to stand before God with our mouths shut. Guilty and accountable before God, and let him determine what he's going to do with us. Here is the beauty of salvation. What we're saying is that he... who he calls, he justifies. That means God has determined to do a certain thing for us.
Amen.
Blessings to the birthday girl, Sister B. Bless you, sis. Amen. And so when God looks at his people, he looks at his people through the lens of what Christ has done for them.
Amen.
If he looked at me in my guilt, his holiness would consume. But there is a challenge, if you will, when we think about a holy God and a sinful people. The first thing I want to say is to be a sinner is a blessing. Because he only saves sinners. To have inabilities and incapable of meeting God's standards is a blessing. Listen to this, when you know that's the truth. See, I was a sinner. And I didn't really understand it, because I would look at people like, well, I ain't done that. You know, I ain't do that kind of stuff. I'll never do that. Right. So I had some judgment to kind of prop myself up in some kind of, listen to this, self-deceived righteousness that I try to create for myself.
Yeah.
But when you come, listen to this, by God's spirit, listen to this, and you come before the holiness of God, and you will be by yourself when you come.
Yes.
When you get to that place, and God's reality terrifies you. I think it's not in this passage, because you hear these words of he glorified, he justified. One of the works God has to do first is terrify.
Yes.
He has to terrify.
Yes. Yes.
Come on. He has to bring us to a knowledge of not only our sin, but who our sin is against and what our sins deserve.
Yes.
If that don't rise up in me, I'm not looking for salvation. I'm not desperate for salvation if I don't understand that. Listen to this. I am ruined. I am undone. I need some help, and that help can't come from me. It has to come from the outside. Now, listen to this. Whatever way you describe God, please give me that way.
Yes.
And then, you know, when he terrifies you, that's when he points you to Jesus.
That's right. Yes.
Listen to what God has done in salvation. God has heaped upon him all of our sin.
Yes.
He looked at his innocent son and he declared guilty. So that he could look at a guilty people and because of his son declare innocent.
Yes.
Do you see the transformation that God has done? Listen to this. I'm still guilty.
Yes.
But he declares me innocent, not based on something I've done, but because of what Christ has done.
Yes.
Romans 4:5 talks about salvation being not according to works, but those who believe, listen to this, in the God who justifies the ungodly. God who declares righteous folks who ain't righteous. Now, we got to deal with the reality. I go back in the courtroom scene. Imagine the courtroom is happening in the courtroom. Somebody is on trial for murder. And it's somebody you know. It ain't like detached, like, oh, that's bad. It's like, man, I'm hot. And the judge comes to the stand, and you know all the evidence, the videotape, the dude is guilty.
Yeah.
And he declares him innocent.
Come on.
Lets him go scot-free. Just think about the anger that's going to rise up in you. You don't want to take justice in your own hands. But this is the God that we serve, that he looks at the guilty, caught red-handed. Got all the evidence, the tapes, the files, everything. You did it. You guilty.
Yeah.
And because of Christ, he looks at that person and says, innocent. Forget about it. The God who cast all of our sin into the sea, or our sin into the sea of forgetfulness, that's the God we serve. Now, when I look at that other person, I still might feel funny. Until it's me that's on the trial stand. And I got all the evidence on me, and I'm caught red-handed. Listen to this. And he declared me innocent, let me go scot-free. Hallelujah. Lord, I thank you. I give you praise. I don't even care who mad about it right now. I thank you. That's one of the things I love about my brother's testimony. He said, I did some stuff. I was in the jail cell for some stuff.
Yes.
But the Lord set him free.
Yes.
That's a picture of our salvation. The God who declares innocent guilty folks. Psalm 130 says it this way. The psalmist said, Lord, if you counted our sins against us, who would be able to stand? Like, if he had a moment where he thought about it. Like, God, I look at my resume. In my resume before you, I got a lot of good stuff on my resume. You know, I've done some good stuff. But if I try to use my resume for my standing, I'm in a bad situation. Because as soon as I slide my resume on the table of my good, that resume of bad come back. And they got more stuff on that resume than my little sheet of good. So there's no balancing on our end. God does all of the balancing on his side. Think about this. In the book of Exodus, God gives us a great picture of the salvation of the soul of his people, as you have a people trapped in bondage, cannot get free. They are oppressed by sin. They are depressed because they can't get out of it. They've given up on God, and they just dealing with life as it is. But God doesn't forget his promise.
Come on, guys. Come on, good God. Come on.
We're talking about the God who foreknows. The God who predetermines, I have a people and I'm not going to let my people go without me. Listen to this. No matter how much sin I had going on in my life, I could not escape the call God had on my life. And the day of salvation, when it came, I couldn't ignore it.
Come on.
Not because I was able to hear, but because he caused me to hear.
Hallelujah.
He opened up deaf ears. He gave eyes that had sight to see. Now I see what they told
you
about.
Lord.
That's the work of God.
Yes.
That's not the wisdom and smartness or the willingness of humanity. The Bible says he works in us to will and to do of his good pleasure. If I wasn't pleased, listen to this, to serve him, that wasn't my desire. I was not after him.
Yes.
But I'm so glad
he
was after me. And he didn't take no for an answer. I remember when I was playing football in college and thought I was somebody. And there would be, campus ministry folks who would say, "Hey, man, great game. You know, we having this Bible study or we having this, And I knew about Jesus. But I didn't know Jesus.
Right.
And I sometimes, for being a nice person, I say, "Yeah, man, I might come through, but I'm knowing I ain't going over there. That's going to mess up my flow. I finally got it how I want it right now. I got the city of the seas. I'm doing my thing." But listen to this. With all of my no's, all of my moments, God didn't even let me forget them. He had some of them in my mind so that I would have another reason to praise him, because I would say, listen to this, if you would have left it up to me, God, I never would be receiving and enjoying what I have right now. But you kept working. You kept knocking, and one day there was a knock that, listen, I had to answer the door. I couldn't pretend like I didn't hear that knock. That's the God who awakens the dead.
Jesus.
He gives life to folks who don't want it. Listen to this. He rises up on you, and the next thing you know, you see what you never saw before. And there's no denying that when you're made to see it. I remember being a young person and had to go to church, and I just didn't understand what all the jumping and running, and I just like I didn't like, why did she run off that? but when I came to see it for myself, when I came to see, listen to this, how God gets in your life and causes you to know that there's things that's happening for you, things that's not happening to you, and all of those things that's working on your behalf is because he's working. I remember a moment in my journey, and here goes back to that courtroom. I had, I didn't have no license when I was in college. I was driving on suspended license, got pulled over a couple of times. So I had warrants for my arrest, even though I was in Portland while I was in California. So when I got back to California, college football was over. One day I get pulled over, and I know it's all bad. I know, I start putting stuff up and all that. And the guy was kind of nice. He gave me a ticket, but I had to go to court. And going to court, they said, basically, you got a couple weeks. You need to pay this fine, or you can do the 30 days in jail. Now, I don't want to do no 30 days in jail. But I don't got the money, though. So there was this moment, and, my father is on his own journey. He's been in prison most of my life, and he was out. I didn't know it at the time, but we reconnected, and he had called me, and actually he texted me. I mean, not text, paged me. I had a pager. I went to a meeting at Lake Merritt Bakery, and we talked for a few minutes, and he said, "Junior, I want to give you something, Junior." And my father gave me like $2,700. And my ticket was $2,300. And so I had maybe a couple days to pay it. So I was going to go pay it on that Tuesday. But I went to church on that Sunday. And I'm in Sunday. I'm on the front row. I'm feeling real good right now. And they singing. And all the song was, "Jesus, he will fix it." And they singing. And something start bubbling up on the inside. Next thing I know, I took off running. My eyes was wet. Not just because a way had been made out of no way, but God made a way out of no way in the most inconceivable way possible. The most unexpected way that you could ever imagine. To where I had no idea or no doubt in my mind, he did that. My father did that. He did that. The witness of God, he has a way of leaving evidence in a personal way. The way he got to talk to you for you to know that it's him that's working on your behalf may not be the way he talked to me, but God has a way of speaking our language so that there's no doubt in our mind about who is working. This is the God who calls us, who justifies us, makes us right with himself. I go back to Exodus, and there's people who are in bondage. And God, in a display of his own glory, coming against all the false gods that have been worshipped in this world, using Egypt as a mainframe of a type of this world. And he rises up in 9 plagues, and we know that 10th plague, he declares simply this: I'm coming by, and the death angel was coming, and he's going to kill the firstborn of every household. Unless there's blood on the door. God describes the way of salvation. He begins to talk about the type of lamb and what you got to do with that lamb. A lamb that got to be tender, and a lamb that's young, that's close to the family. You got to spend some time with that lamb and get close to it. Like, that's the lamb you're going to have to kill. Now you have to take a note of that for a second. He calls the family to spend time with that lamb. That for that whole week, that lamb will be identified as the one, and they had to pay attention to that lamb. And that would be the very lamb that the family would have to kill to put the blood on the doorpost. Salvation, he says, he makes it cost something for us. He makes us recognize the preciousness of the one who was slain on our behalf. And the blood had to be put on the door. And God simply said it this way: even though he was coming against the world, he didn't make any division. He said, whoever don't have the blood on the door, the death angel gonna get you. My people, not my people, it don't matter. There's one way I'm gonna save anybody, is if blood is on the door. Look what he said. Not when I see you praying. Not when I see your tears. Not when I see you read the Bible. He said, when I come through, I'm looking for one thing. When I see the blood, I'll pass over. Come on. Oh, he's covered in the blood. How did I get the blood on me? That's God's work. That he applied, listen to this, what Christ accomplished to my account. My account ain't got nothing in it. Matter of fact, I'm on the negative side. But God, the Bible talks about what giving us righteousness is, that he reckons and he credits to our account a full righteousness, not partial. You halfway right. Either you right or you not right. And there's one way to get right, and that's the blood.
Yes, sir.
The blood, they son, would never lose its power.
Come on now.
That the blood still avails. The blood speaks a sure hope for us. That the blood is what God is looking for. And so what God has done is he has put a people in Christ. So that all that Christ has accomplished is credited to our account. As I said earlier, all that we've done was put in his account. He had to take that and deal with that register. But he said, I'm going to do it. Look what the Bible says, how he did it, the attitude he had. It said, for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross, despising the shame. Listen to this, we who deserve shame could be set right with God. The scripture tells us, and I'm going to get ready to close here, how God does this is a blessing. 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 21 simply says this: he made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, that we might be made the righteousness of God. Listen to this. In him. Location. How did I get in him? How did the blood get applied to me? Well, the scripture says God did that. It says he has translated us out of the kingdom of darkness. And he has put us into the kingdom of his dear son. How did I, without moving my feet, God changed my destiny.
Hallelujah.
Without a move, it was in a flash of revelation where I saw the truth. And in an instant, see, justification is an instantaneous, one-time declaration from God that declares to that individual, me and you on good terms. He lets us know why we on good terms with him. It's all because of Christ. And he causes us, listen to this, so that what I need constantly is why we desire to be a gospel preaching church, is because what God pours into me often leaks out. Yes. He tells me I'm his. He tells me I can't be lost. Jesus said, you in my head and in the Father's head, and no man can pluck you out. But there's moments when life turned around on me, and I'm not sure. Have you ever been there? It's like, okay, I know I'm sad. I don't know me. It's like, hey, is he turning against me? Like, I don't know if all of the promises. I need the gospel to be preached to my conscience.
Yes.
Because that's where the warfare is.
Yes.
And the words, listen to this, the word of God speaks my fears down.
Yes.
Speaks my concerns down.
Yes.
Listen to this. Jesus, it said Jesus came into this world preaching peace. Mm-hmm. I'm going to turn right quick to something. Ephesians. And I'll close with reading this and give a little application. We'll pray and then we'll take the Lord, go to the Lord's table. Ephesians chapter 2. Look at the miracle of salvation. Chapter 2, look at verse number 1. It simply says this, and you were dead. Mm-hmm. Now listen to that. Dead people don't make decisions. Dead people can't respond. You could talk to a dead person, but they won't move. If they do, run. But he says, you, listen to this, spiritually were dead. Could not hear God, couldn't understand, was at war and enmity with God. Like there was a gap between the two. You were dead in trespasses and sins. He says, in which you once walked, once lived, following the course of this world. Meaning that's the natural way everybody goes.
Yes.
Like God has to do something to get us to go his way. Listen, if he had not chosen some, heaven would have none.
Come on.
If God had not determined to have a people for himself, that's what he told Elijah. He said, Elijah, I'm the only one left. He said, hold on a second. I have reserved for myself 7,000 men who haven't bowed the knee to Baal. Like, I will have a people and I will keep me a people that I might have a witness in this world.
Amen.
We are. Again, the only one that's going to be able to do the bragging at the end is God. He going to be like, let me tell you the story of what I had to do to get him. He was tucked over there. He was running over there. He was chasing all that. And let me tell you what I did.
Yeah.
And we just going to stand up and be like, And listen to this. Gladly.
Come on.
Let him have all the glory.
Yes. Yes.
Because if it had not been for the Lord who was on our side, I don't actually know where I would be, but I know what I would be. I'd still be lost in my sin. Still lost in the darkness. As one of my boys say, like a goose in a snowstorm. Everything white, I can't see nothing.
Yes, sir.
But because God got active and brought me out, I'm one who can rejoice. And his salvation.
Thank you, Lord.
When you were dead in trespasses and sins in which you once walked, following the course, the pattern of this world, following the prince of the power of the air, the spirit that is at work in the sons of disobedience, that's bondage. That's being controlled. That's being like, I can't get free. The scripture tells us that he has set us free, delivered us from the hand of the enemy that was stronger than us. We weren't going to be able to whoop the devil to get out. We was captive. And would have stayed there unless God had decided to come rescue us. Among whom, in verse 3, we all once lived in the passions of our flesh, carrying out the desires of the body and of the mind. And we're by nature children of wrath. By nature, just by being born. Like, being born is the cause for judgment. Not, I did wrong. I did wrong because I'm already wrong. The Bible said I'm born in trespasses and sins. Just think about it. Here's the hope of salvation, and here's the necessity. The baby, just born, in the crib, cute, pretty, nothing is wrong, smell good, even with the boo-boo cover. It's like, oh, look at the baby. It's just no problems. That baby must be saved. But that baby, without Christ responding and opening up that baby's eye, that baby is lost. Without doing anything but being born, there's a necessity that God does something. It says that we were in this state in verse 5. It says, well, verse 4, but God.
But God.
But, like, it was bad, 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 but God.
But God.
Being rich in mercy, not giving us what we deserve.
Yes,
because of the great love with which he has loved us, even when we were dead in trespasses and sins, made us alive together. You got to deal with that word made.
Yes.
That's, I said it last week, that's the cat on the gurney. He gone. Hmm. But they get the thing, you know, that
yeah,
clear,
clear,
boom. Salvation is a resurrection from the dead. He says here, even when we were dead in our trespasses, he made us alive together with Christ. By grace you have been saved and raised up with him and seated us with him in heavenly places in Christ Jesus. So that in the coming ages he might show the immeasurable riches of his grace and kindness towards us in Christ Jesus. For by grace you have been saved through faith. And this is not your own doing. It is the gift of God.
Yes.
It is not your own doing.
Yes.
It is the gift of God.
Yes.
You have been saved by grace through faith.
Yes.
It is not your own doing. What is it? It, the grace that gave you faith, is the result of your salvation. To trust in Christ is a gift of God's grace.
Yes.
How did I get from, I don't need Jesus, to, man, I need Jesus? How did I get to that place? Grace awakened my dead heart. Caused me to see it the way God sees it.
Yes.
See, this is the challenge that must be overcome, is that I got my own opinions.
Yes.
Left to myself, I might have thought Jesus was a moral teacher. He's a great leader, great example. You can get a lot of quotes from Jesus that apply to life, but I never would have saw him as the Savior, as the Messiah, as my only hope for salvation with God. Unless the miracle of grace happened on the inside to cause me to see it the way God sees
them. Thank you, Lord.
He goes on, and I'm closing here. He says, verse 9, it is not a result of work, so that no one may boast, for we are his workmanship. The work of art God created, his people, carved out of darkness. It says, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared before him, that we should walk in them. And then he says, all right, now that's what you are now. But don't forget something. Remember that at one time, you Gentiles in the flesh, called the uncircumcision by what is called the circumcision, which is made in the flesh by hands. Remember that you were at that time separated, listen to this, from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, and strangers to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in this world. That's a difficult place to be. Now, not knowing that you need God, you think, I don't need God. I'm cool. They can have all that. But being brought to the realization of the way this world is and the evilness that's in this world, and then the evilness that's on the inside of him that will work with the evilness that's out there, and listen, rejoice in it, praise it, agree with it.
Yes.
And to be like, man, and then the result and penalty for going that way and not his way is eternal damnation. To be without God in this world is a difficult thing.
Yes.
There is no hope, because death is coming for all of us.
It's
appointed unto man once to die, and after that there's a judgment. What is he going to judge? Do I see blood on the door?
Come on.
Yes, Lord.
That's the only hope.
Yes,
so for him to apply the blood to my account is a gift. But listen, and I'm closing. It says, but now, in Christ Jesus, you who were once far off, has he brought near by the blood of Christ. For he himself is our peace, who made us both one, and has broken down in his flesh the dividing wall of hostility, by abolishing the law of commandments expressed in ordinances, that he might create in himself one new man in place of the two, so making peace, and might reconcile us both. He's talking Jews and Gentiles, outsiders and insiders, both to God in one body through the cross, thereby killing the hostility. And he came and preached peace to you who were far off. I just want to stop right there. He came to where you were, and he preached peace.
Yes, Lord.
Last illustration.
Thank you,
Jesus promising his disciples, we are on our way to the other side. Yes. I got work to do that's on that side that we got to get over there to do it. Jesus, knowing what he said, goes into the boat, goes to the bottom, and goes to sleep. The disciples, in the midst, a couple ways off, the storm rises up seemingly out of nowhere, but Jesus knew it was coming. The storm comes, and they are terrified to the point of all is going to be lost. They go down in the ship, and they wake Jesus up, saying, don't you care about us? We're about to perish. We're about to be lost. We're about to be destroyed. And Jesus awakens, and he goes out to where the storm is. And he simply says a couple things. He says, peace. See, that's preaching. He said he came preaching peace. Jesus wasn't first, I think, talking to the storm when he said peace. He was saying peace to his disciples. Be at rest. Be confident. Be secure. Yes. Listen to this. Yes. If I'm on board, the ship can't go down.
Yes.
Christ being you, you got a hope to glory. And this is where we are able to absolutely rest in life. He has the power to tell our situation.
Yes, Lord.
Be still.
Comfort my heart. And got the power to deal with my situation.
Yes.
The comfort of my heart is sometimes he'll leave the situation a little bit longer. He'll let the storm keep raging because he said, I want to build up your faith.
Yes.
I want to recognize that you know who's on board.
Yes.
That if I'm for you, who could be against you?
Yes.
Sometimes he leaves us in turbulence just long enough to let faith kick in. Yes. Sometimes you're autopilot thinking Jesus on my side because he on my side, everything gonna work out good. Yes. Jesus said, I'll surprise you and turn life upside down. Because I'm not after giving you perfect circumstance. I'm after bringing you to a greater dependence and a greater reliance upon who I am on your behalf.
Yes.
That you'll see the blood keep working on your behalf.
Hello.
I was talking to somebody yesterday. He said, man, I thank God for the stuff he saved me from that I know. Mm-hmm. But he said, I also thank God for the stuff he saved me from that I got no idea. I can't even count those.
Because
I don't even know, but I know he's done some of them.
He
came preaching peace. It's how he justifies his people.
Yep.
He doesn't come to you in judgment. Christ didn't come into the world to condemn. He came so that the world might be saved.
Thank you, Lord.
So, Father, we thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
That salvation is all in your hands.
Yes. Yes.
You who foreknew a people, you predestined them.
Yes.
And in your predestinating work, determine it. They will be yours. You one day in this life, you called them out of darkness into the marvelous light.
Yes.
And when you called them to yourself, you didn't call them telling them to fix themselves and get it right and measure up to your standards, for you knew we couldn't measure up.
Yes.
You applied all of the work that Christ accomplished with his perfect life. First of all, he lived the life we're supposed to live.
Yes.
And in his death, he died the death that we deserve, so that because of him, we can be acceptable in your sight. You credited his work to our account.
Thank you, Lord.
Yes.
And for that, God, we will be singing praises for all of eternity.
Yes.
Worthy is the Lamb who has accomplished all of our salvation and redemption for his people. We are a distinct people. We have been known by you from before the world was ever framed.
Yes.
And you are a God who is faithful to your promise. And therefore, we witness that you've done it on our behalf.
Yes.
I thank you for your people. As we prepare to come to the table, this is a way that we respond. That we come to you receiving again as a symbolic gesture, as remembering your life poured out, your life extinguished. The cost was blood. The cost was death. You had to lose so that we could win.
Yes, Lord. Thank you.
And so we prepare to come to this table with thanksgiving in our heart. We give you praise. We give you glory for this ability you've given us, this covenant, this sacrament you've set before us as a way, as a community, to remember your precious gift to us. You didn't give things, you gave yourself. praise you for it. It's in Jesus' name that we pray. Amen and amen.